Hello, 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 hello. Can you all hear me? How's everybody doing? How's everybody doing? Everybody turn around and wave to everybody on Facebook Live. Hello, everybody. Basically say, hi, Mitali's mom. My name is Mitali Chakraborty. I will be your MC, mainly because Brenda and Quincy, who leads this program, had a glass of wine and sent me an email. So that's the only credentials I have to be here today. I have been working with Anita B since March. I first came in as an interim VP of partnerships. So thank you to all of our partners and sponsors. I now serve as an executive consultant for the organization. As I like to say, I just have my hand in a lot of cookie jars, and I don't even like cookies. So we're here today for the 2019 PitcHER competition. Okay, so everybody knows why we're here, right? You're not in the wrong room. Also, let's everybody grab a seat. Fill in up front. For those of you walking in, don't be shy. Come on up. So this is the second year for the pitch competition. We're going to be giving away $100,000 to four different winners. I repeat, $100,000. So before we get started, I'm going to do a quick visual. Can I get everybody to stand up? Everybody standing. Just imagine there's 200 people in this room, okay? So in 2017, amongst all startups and the bazillions of dollars out there, only 16% went to an organization or company that had a woman as a co-founder. 16%. So I'm gonna have that side of the room sit down. I'm gonna have this entire middle section sit down. Everybody but the first four rows sit down. So now look around. If every one of you represented an organization either co-founded or founded by a woman, only this group over here would potentially get funding. Now I'm going to have the last three rows sit down for me. And I need one, two, three, four of you stay standing. Gokindi and Frishta sit down. And out of all of the money, only 2.2% went to a female-founded organization. That's it. We got to do better. We're going to do better, and Anita B is going to do their part. So if you're watching at home and you got a lot of money, invest in women. So that's what we're here to do today, is invest in women. You guys can have a seat. Thank you. Got that visual? We've got to do better. Next year, hopefully we only sit half the room down in 1 year. Okay, first off, I would like to thank some people for being here and recognize them. Our esteemed judges. First up, we have Alejandra Castillo. Please stand up. She is the CEO of YWCA USA. Raise your hand if you've ever gone to something at the YWCA. Thank you. She's also a former member of the Obama administration and was the director of the Minority Business Development Agency, the first Latina woman to hold that position, and helped create or retain over 33,000 jobs. Amazing. She's a native New Yorker who currently lives in DC, and her last passport stamp was at the Dominican Republic. So go visit the DR. Next up, we have Christy Pitts, general partner at Backstage Capital, who is investing in women. Christy helped launch the accelerator program that they have in four cities right now. And fun fact, you can't see it, but I guarantee her shoe game is better than your game. Next up, we have Shakia Kegler. She is, just so you all know, the first PitcHER competition winner for founding GovLia, a business-to-government marketplace. Amazing. Thank you, Shakia. Fun fact, she's a member of the Beehive. Do you know what that is? It's like the Beyonce followers, so don't mess with old girl. Thank you for being here. We also have Kat Manalek from Y Combinator. Fun fact, she was the chief of staff for Alexis Ohanian, so I'm just assuming at this point she's best friends with Serena Williams. So if you could put that ask in to get Serena here for 2020, that's on you. Fun fact, she is a native to the Bay Area, and also she's got a guilty pleasure of 90s television. So currently binging Frasier. Let's give it up for our judges. They've got a lot of work today. They have $100,000 to give away. And we wouldn't be here without our amazing sponsors. If we can get all the sponsor reps to join us up front. Do we have y'all? Let's give it up for the sponsors! First up, I'm gonna have Deborah Blanser from American Family Insurance come up and say a few words. She's gonna come off, and I'm just gonna say your name. I'm not gonna go back up there.
Good afternoon. It is a pleasure to be here. I am Debbie Brantzel from American Family Insurance. We are a large technology mutual insurance company. At American Family, we inspire, protect, and restore the dreams that our customers work so hard to achieve. In the digital era, that means securing more data, building better analytical and modeling capabilities, and delivering more personalized risk products. To provide what our customers need, we have assembled a portfolio of amazing tech investments that hold the data and capabilities to tackle new risks and seize opportunities presented by the modern world. It's why we are investing in market-leading technical talent, like the great women in this room, to build new products and forge surprising partnerships. Many see risk as an obstacle to overcome. At American Family, we see it as an invitation to innovate. Join us in reinventing an industry that makes everyone's lives better. I look forward to speaking with many of you later today, and I can't wait to see these pitches. Thank you.
Grasshopper Bank.
No, isn't it? It's like this, right? So I'm CEO of Grasshopper Bank, a new digital business bank focused on the innovation ecosystem. So startups, investors in startups, and entrepreneurs. That's what I am. I was asked 3 years ago to consider starting a venture bank based in New York. I went and looked at all the existing banks that were there, and there's a lot. And what I found so alarmed me that I had to say yes. What I found were management teams that were all middle-aged white men, and I found boards who were older white men, and it made me mad. And so went about creating a bank with a differentiated technology strategy meant to change banking from where it is today. I'm part of the 1%, not the 1% everyone rails about. I'm one of the 1% of bank CEOs who are women, which in and of itself is pretty bad. So, I have a big chip on my shoulder. This is about women in financial services and period. And this is about, I moved to New York 10 years ago from Silicon Valley, so I kind of have my bullseye on Silicon Valley. So take it personally. So anyway, we're recruiting. We actually have a Grace Hopper graduate engineer who's here representing us, Kara Lang. And we are also looking for startups and investors. So come talk to us. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Deborah.
Wait a minute. I forgot to tell you why we're here. We're actually named after Grace Hopper. That's where Grasshopper came from. So,
thank you, Judy. Next up is Opal Perry from Hertz.
Hi, I'm the Chief Information Officer at Hertz. I'm really excited to be here at my third Grasshopper, but it's my first with the fabulous Hertz team. We've got a great team here that specialize in telematics, connectivity, our mobile apps, our website, a lot we're doing through our Rev Labs to drive revenue and new business models for the company. You know us as the rental car company. We have over 10,000 locations and 150 countries. We're here to get you where you need to go, whether it's renting that car, whether you want to buy a used car. We have a tremendous presence here in the U.S. Or we also rent tens and thousands of vehicles to the rideshare drivers that you may catch rides from wherever you are on campus or in the city that you live in. We are so excited at Hertz. We celebrate a lot the HER in Hertz. And so PitcHER was a fabulous fit for us this year. We have one of the most diverse C-suite teams in the Fortune 500, and it's really exciting to us to support entrepreneurs. We believe in people with a passion and a purpose, and I think I'm so excited to hear the pitches today, and I know that these women and their teams are driving tremendous change. We're really proud to support it from Hertz. Thank you.
Thank you, Opal. Next up for Micron is T. Tran.
Hello, Power Pitchers. I'm T. Tran, VP of DRAM Process Integration of Micron Technology. Micron is a leading provider of advanced semiconductor solutions. Our mission is to be the global leader in memory and storage by offering high-value solutions. We're the fourth largest semiconductor company in the world with global footprint in 18 countries. Micron's DRAM and flash memory products are everywhere. They're in your laptops, computers, networks, servers. They're in the cloud. We're in your cars, cameras, gaming systems, and we're all over on the AI front. Our 34,000-strong team is proud of Micron's innovative history of 41 years, where we have 40,000 patents. I've been at Micron for 11 years, and I look forward to going to work every single day. Having done 3 startups myself, I'm ecstatic that Micron is sponsoring this event today. So let's get this PitcHER party started. Go Micron!
Thank you, T. And last but not least, please welcome Julia Baker from ServiceTitan.
Hello, hi. Thank you to everyone for coming, and especially to those of you who are brave enough to pitch today. Super excited to be here. My name is Julia Baker. I'm Director of Technical Project Management at ServiceTitan. ServiceTitan is a home services company powering the people in the trades, plumbers, HVAC technicians, and we're based in Glendale, California. Here for the first time at Grace Hopper, along with about 17 women from our company as part of our investment into diversity and inclusion initiative, which we consider as critical to our continued growth and success. Our company was started in 2012, which was only a short 7 years ago. Our two co-founders, Ara and Vahi, met in college and undergrad and decided to partner to create this company, which is now in 2019 valued at $1.65 billion and has about 700 employees. So I'm hopeful that this story or this entrepreneurial journey inspires you guys as you pitch today, and I hope that one of your ideas becomes the next billion-dollar idea. So best of luck to you guys. Super excited.
Thank you, Julia. Appreciate it. We'd also like to thank WePay, a JP Morgan Chase company, for also contributing as one of our sponsors. So, okay, I have a couple rules before we get started. Every person that's coming up here to pitch has put their heart and soul and a lot of sweat equity into building these companies. Think of each individual, regardless of who you're here to cheer on, as if they're your best friend, your sister, somebody that you just think is gonna be the next unicorn. Every person deserves a raging, loud entrance, okay? So let's just practice. Please welcome to the stage, CEO and founder, Mitali Chakraborty. All right. We've got 11 amazing pitches, and I want to hear that type of energy for every individual. Okay? All right. Couple things to note. Each person has 3 minutes to pitch, so don't blink. You've got to listen to every word they're saying. They're going to go fast. They're going to give you a lot of information. We have 4 prizes. There is an audience award winner and a first, second, and third prize. A lot of money, $100,000. 3-minute pitches, and then we're going to go to our judges who have questions for up to 2 minutes. So it's fast. So don't go to the bathroom. You're going to miss a lot. Okay? So remember, really loud round of applause welcoming them, a really great exit also, and another great round of applause for the next one. Okay. First up, just so you know, I asked some fun facts, and not only are these really brilliant scientists and engineers and Harvard educated and so on, they also have some interesting things going on in their lives. First up, are we ready? Ready? All right. Yolkindi Valdez is a social entrepreneur, storyteller, and public speaker. As the co-founder and CEO of Forefront, she helps employers and leaders enable their cultural competence and inclusive leadership skills to meet the demands of the emerging workforce. She's an alumni of Babson College, for those of you who don't know, is one of the number one school for entrepreneurship. She's a native Midwesterner like myself, the Indian from Indiana. She's from St. Louis. And fun fact, she was on ESPN for the National Spelling Bee. So first up, please welcome Yolkindi. Good luck, friends. Am I okay?
Hello. My name is Yolkindi Valdez, and I'm the co-founder and CEO at Forefront. On July 5th, 2016, I was on my way to work when I heard about another black man being shot by the police. This time, it was Alton Sterling. Being from Ferguson, Missouri, this hit too close to home. I live in fear of the same happening to my two younger brothers. So imagine me, on that day, walking into the office in tears, only to be received by managers who did not understand my emotions and experiences. So I quit, and I'm not alone. Millennials of color are three times more likely to leave their jobs. The reason being poor culture and bad managers. And this is costing companies billions of dollars each year. So companies now understand that if they want to remain employers of choice, they need to equip their employees better with cultural awareness and sensitivity training. And now they have Forefront to do that for their next generation of the workforce. Forefront is a mobile learning platform that teaches employees how to work effectively in a multicultural and global environment. So how does it work? As a user in our platform, we send you bite-sized courses directly to your phone on topics such as implicit bias or ethical leadership that you can access during your commute or in between meetings. And as you complete them, you get credentials, badges. And as part of that experience, we're building an algorithm, like a dating app, that will connect our users to their colleagues around the world, which makes us a perfect solution for global and remote teams that want to stay connected and learning from each other. And lastly, we have a dashboard tailored to HR leaders, which at the end of the day are our customers, to help them track their employee progress and development. We make money through annual subscription per user, pricing depending on the size of the organization. And we know we have a great product because we already work with the best companies in the world, from SAP to Accenture, and we're supported by the top education and HR technology experts. And today, we have raised $255,000 in non-diluted funding. And today, audience, judges, we hope you become one of our backers and help us raise $35,000 right now to help us get to the next version of our product, run some pilots with early customers before we go to market largely in 2020. Join us in designing a future work that works for all. Thank you, and I'm now ready for your questions.
Amazing. All right, judges, you're up.
Okay, it's tough to start to kick off the competition, but you did a great job. Thank you for your pitch. I wanted to ask, I am a little bit confused about your traction. So on your slide, you said you had 170K in revenue and also 20 partners, but then you just mentioned that you're developing the beta app to go to market. So can you describe where the company is today?
Yeah, no, we've been really scrappy and basically launched with a prototype mix of live training where we actually, my co-founder and I, facilitate in-person trainings and do part of it virtually. So the 100% of the revenue you see is from those early prototypes. So we also work with schools and nonprofits, but find the opportunity in helping enterprises reach mass scale with their training without losing quality. So it was basically from all those early experiments that you see those early revenues.
Great. And then I have one other question, and then I think we open it up to the rest of the judges. So can you talk about, earlier you talked about your experience and why you left the company that you were at. And a big part of it was because the managers that you were working with couldn't relate to you. So can you talk about when you, once you've gone to market, are you planning to have like the entire company use the product? Is it just people in management positions? How does that work?
Especially, yeah, we're marketing ourselves for the next generation of the workforce. The workforce is gonna be 75% millennials. They learn differently, they learn in their phones, and hence why we're focusing on a mobile-first application that facilitates in the flow of work learning. So it's not only about managers, but the next generation of managers and equipping them with the skills that they need.
All right, we'll take one more question.
I'm a manager. Well, first of all, thank you. Congratulations. This is exciting. I'm a manager, and I deal with three generations in the workplace. Yes. And it's going to take time, right? What type of, how do you envision this particular product in terms of the human connection? Are you considering other types of training that you will provide? And how do you imagine scaling that component?
Yeah, so it's an exciting space. Now we have VR training, AI-powered learning experiences, and HR leaders are wondering, how do we keep the human connection? And that's why we're focusing on our algorithm. That's actually connecting people to each other. If I work in the Orlando office, how can I get connected to the folks in Sao Paulo, Brazil, or in China, or Seattle? So a lot of the learning experiences will happen with people are matched with each other, and we're providing curated guides where people can learn different skills, and it's not just cultural competency, that's the beginning. Here you can learn about public speaking, how to be a better leader. We see as the world gets more automated, the importance for soft skills only become more critical, and we wanna be a leader for soft skill development and corporate training.
Amazing.
Thank you.
All the time we have. Congratulations. All right, first one, up and down. Amazing work. All right. Okay, so I just wanted to say, my name is Mitali Chakraborty, and I have a hard name, and my entire life, everyone's butchered it. So I made sure I asked everybody how to pronounce their names, and I forgot half of them. So I wanted to give my caveat, just in case I mess it up. Next up, we have Dr. Farishte Almifer, who is the founder and CEO of Pediametrics, an early-stage startup in Maryland that aims to revolutionize pediatric health through AI and image processing. She holds 3 U.S. patents already. So I guess I'm behind in patent holding. And the fun fact is, she wanted everybody to know that she's really excited to be here, but she's definitely missing her 2-year-old at home, Ryan. So hello, Ryan. Next up, Dr. Farishte.
Good afternoon. My name is Farishte Almifer, and I am a research scientist with a PhD from Johns Hopkins University, and I am founder and CEO of Pediametrics. Let me start with the personal story that made me begin this journey. This is my son, Ryan. When Ryan was 2 months old, he developed a condition that is very common among newborns called flathead syndrome. Being an immigrant first-time mom, I was so worried and had feelings of guilt for not being able to prevent that from happening. But later on, I realized that actually up to 30% of newborns develop moderate to severe flathead after the Back to Sleep campaign. And $1 billion is being spent on management of this condition, yet lots of infants remain untreated. The reason is that at-home treatment, even though effective if it started early, it's largely unsuccessful due to late diagnosis. And helmet therapy is expensive and very cumbersome. That's why we came up with SoftSpot, a mobile app that uses advanced patented image processing methods to empower parents and pediatricians. For the first time, they can use their smartphone in their pocket, take a couple of photos of the baby's head, and receive the type and severity of flathead and patient-specific instructions for at-home treatment. They will be able to monitor the progress during the course of therapy. SoftSpot backend technology is protected internationally through our PCT patent. The product market fit has been tested with 200 interviews with pediatric clinicians and parents, and it has already been tested by pilot patients. Our revenue model is based on $30 per month subscription fee, and that leads us to $480 million revenue in US and potential of growth to other parts of the world as we have received interest from other countries as well. We have received $300,000, mostly non-dilutive grants from National Science Foundation, and now we are in the middle of a fundraising that will enable us to go through regulatory process, further app development, and pilot tests. We need to develop HIPAA-compliant app, and if we win this competition, we will make sure that we do it as soon as possible. We have an exceptional team of scientists and thought leaders in the pediatric community, all of us driven for the bigger mission of pediatrics, which is bringing artificial intelligence to pediatric care. Imagine how much impact we can have on women's life if we make sure every mom is resourceful, no matter where they live and where they come from. We are looking for a talent in image processing and computer vision, so if you are interested, come talk to me. We also need your help now to bring SoftSpot to parents. If you're a parent of a newborn or a pediatrician or you know someone who is, please ask them to sign up in our website and help us with getting access to more data. Thank you.
Thank you so much for sharing what you're building. I have a couple questions. What's your timeline? When do you think you're going to have the first version of the app launched? And second, what are you thinking in terms of reaching potential parents who could be your users? How do you plan to do that at scale?
Sure. Our plan is to launch the beta testing in next summer. For reaching to parents, our channel would be mainly pediatricians. Through our interviews, we have done like 230 interviews with pediatric clinicians, and we have found a lot of interest. 10 centers are already waiting for us to launch and be able to reach parents.
Do you have any, so what needs to happen specifically between now and the launch this summer?
First, FDA. We have been in communication with FDA, and most probably we can design the feature so that we are exempt, but they asked us to do an official determination. That's a 3-month process. And then after that, we are through the grant that we have from National Science Foundation. We are performing more algorithm testing and pilots, and after that we will be able to launch the beta app.
Oh, great, great presentation, honestly. My question is, so for the $30 a month subscription, will a particular client
hold? 5 months, because we recommend that they start at 4 weeks of age and then continue the conservative at-home treatment by 6 months of age. And if it is not treated, then we refer them for helmet therapy, so they will be taken care of after that. It's 5 months.
I just need a point of clarification. Are you saying that this is a product that parents will be able to use at their homes without any type of medical supervision?
The pediatrician, so there will be two logins. Pediatrician will be able to see the data, but parents will be able to take the picture at home and see also the instructions for at-home treatment and be supervised by
So it is being monitored by a physician at some
yes.
point?
Yes, their pediatrician.
So you're not running any legal risk. You're not running the risk of providing medical advice through
No.
an app.
Okay. No.
Can you explain again the FDA? You're waiting for the FDA because you want to be exempt? Is that what you said?
Yes. So if you are only a measurement tool, they have told us that we are most probably exempt. But if you are going to add treatment features for the guidance, then that might be extra features that needs 510K.
Thank you.
Thank you, judges. Thank you so much for
Thank
your time.
You.
Appreciate it. All right, and just a reminder, if you're posting on social, hashtag GHC19, hashtag PitcHER 19, P-I-T-C-H-E-R 19, if you haven't gotten that because it's on the screen. Next up, we have Asha Owens. Asha is the co-founder and CEO of Best Fit, a company whose mission is to close the gap in college decision making and create a clearer, more defined path to college and career. She's also a product engineer and full stack web developer, so an underachiever, obviously. Asha is also a member of Dev Color, a founder in the Dorm Room Fund's Blueprint Project. And also, I asked her, if you had to eat one meal, every meal for the rest of your life, what would it be? The best answer ever, mac and cheese. Awesome. Please welcome Asha Owens.
Hi, I'm Asha Owens, CEO of Best Fit. I chose my college without ever stepping foot on campus. I relied on brochures and websites, and here's where I struggled. There are over 5,000 colleges in the United States, and their marketing materials all look the same. There are girls in white lab coats and students studying on the ground. Now, I took a gamble on Brown, and because of images like these, I thought that all I had to do was show up and do well, and the rest would fall in place. It didn't, and that's because there's a hidden curriculum to college success. I wish someone would have told me that focusing on my relationships and my internships was just as important as focusing on my coursework. And I'm not alone. 75% of low-income, minority, and first-generation students who attend college will not graduate. Like me, they're shown images of success, but they're not given the networks and the resources they need to succeed. This is where Best Fit comes in, and we're using data and storytelling to completely reimagine the college decision-making process. Our free college discovery tool centers on the experiences of real college students. We use videos to capture the lessons that they've learned and the resources that they found most valuable. High schoolers find Best Fit more personal and easier to understand, and 75% of our students say that our videos help them learn something new about college. Counselors love the fact that Best Fit is a hub for them to leverage their recent alumni who are in college right now. So, for instance, if I had recorded a video for my counselor, any student at my high school could learn from my experiences at Brown. High schools purchase Best Fit to scale the work of their counselors, all while removing the hidden barriers to college success. But this is just the beginning. By next year, 65% of jobs will require a post-secondary education. And Best Fit is well positioned to help colleges who lose $50 billion a year to poor recruiting and retention. We're using the success of our pilot study to expand our market in New York City, which is at $55 million. We're closing our first three contracts this month, and our partnership with College Access for All will add an additional 400 high schools to our pipeline. We're a team of educators and engineers that are building a product that redefines what an equitable college-going education looks like. And together, we've taken Best Fit from a winning idea to a company funded by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. We're currently raising $300,000, which will set us up to reach 50 high schools by the fall of 2020. There's a hidden curriculum to college success, and we need your support to ensure that students have the knowledge and networks they need to ace it. Thank you.
Excellent job, by the way. First question is, it's regarding the business model. So you have yearly subscriptions with government aid or the high schools. Mm-hmm. How does that usually work? Do you usually speak with the school board or the high mm-hmm. school?
Yep, so it works at the individual level right now. Ideally, we'll be working at the district level eventually. And there are two parts, the curriculum that supplements the platform, and then the platform which allows schools to manage both their current students and then their alumni. And then those contracts range from the starting price for the curriculum, $3,000, and then for the technology is $8,000.
And who's paying for the curriculum side of it?
The schools. Oh. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and specifically with College Access for All, the schools within that partnership have a specific budget dedicated toward that money. And then as an approved vendor, they can spend that money on Best Fit.
Can you talk about the process to get content from the colleges into the app?
Mm-hmm. Yep, so a lot of the data comes from publicly available databases. And then what we're doing now is a lot of the resources that we focus on are specifically geared toward marginalized students. So we're experimenting with how we use technology to gather this information from their websites and then put it into Best Fit. And one of the ways that we're doing that now is just by sending surveys to college representatives and saying, you know, we're building this app. What are three resources you want low-income minority and first-gen students to know about?
We'll take one more question.
I'm always very curious. This is amazing because every time I heard you speak, it felt like I was going through that process because that was exactly my experience. Question for you: as you bring in the college students, have you contemplated how you can also provide services in terms of retaining, particularly students of color within the college setting?
Mm-hmm. Yep, and that's definitely one of our long-term goals, to focus on college retention. And one of the ways that we're trying to do that is by starting earlier, helping students make better decisions, and recognizing that, you know, current education focuses on very short-term problems, and we want to really give students the foresight to know that if I'm dealing with food insecurity or housing insecurity, who do I go to solve these problems so I don't have to forfeit my college education?
Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, Asha Owens. So fun fact, I actually have a picture on my alma mater's website for like the longest time. I went to Emory University and I was that person sitting on the ground. Like, and I think it was up for like 5 years. I'm like, I'm out. All right, I feel as though the energies are getting a little low. So just remember, everybody gets the best welcome to the stage, okay? Next up, we have Kyle DeManis. Kyle is one of the co-founders and CEO of R6 Industries. She's a biomedical engineer from Georgia Tech, go Yellow Jackets, and is currently studying to be a doctor, because, you know, an engineer is now going to be a doctor. Underachievers in this room. I asked her for a couple fun facts. First, she told me that she really loves oysters, and I didn't want to tell her that she lives in landlocked, like, Atlanta, but, you know. So we went with the fact that she's an ultimate Frisbee player. So please welcome to the stage, Kyle. Good luck.
Hi everyone, my name is Kyle and I'm the CEO and co-founder of R6 Industries, and we're building the foundation for new disaster technology in healthcare. Meet Jamie, a 43-year-old school teacher from Derry County, North Carolina. When Hurricane Dorian struck just a few weeks ago, Jamie and her family were forced to flee their homes and go to a disaster shelter. And what's even worse is while evacuating, Jamie's father was wounded, her daughter was pregnant, and someone in the shelter caught the flu. Can you just imagine having to go through that with your family in these chaotic environments? And if you're running the shelter, how can you make sure that their family gets the medical care that they need while preventing anyone else from getting sick? So for organizations running these shelters, like the Red Cross, the problem is that there's a lack of accessible real-time healthcare information in disaster shelters. And currently, they rely on paper and phone to coordinate care. And even worse is that more than 31 million people are going through this in the world every year. And 3 out of 4 of those people have an immediate medical need. So we sought to solve this problem, and we created DisasterMed, a medical needs platform that allows for managing of these healthcare needs in disasters, especially for the underserved community. And we do this in 3 ways. First, pre-disaster. We've created a pre-registry public health database that allows you to better prepare for the disaster. Second, during disaster. We intake evacuees from this database, but also pull in existing electronic medical records to streamline care. We've also designed an algorithm that tracks disease outbreak. And then finally, post-disaster. Currently, disaster data is not being tracked, so we plan to collect that for predictive analytics. So in 2018, just between the US government and the Red Cross, more than $470 million were spent on disaster relief healthcare in the United States. Now, this is a global problem, estimated at $4.5 billion, but we're focusing first on the US, starting at the local, the state, then the federal level. Our competitors have designed resource tracking systems, but do not track individual medical needs. These are all the pilot agreements that we have in place with our partners, and with their reach, we have the possibility to impact at least 20,000 evacuees just with these pilot studies. And this is just the beginning. You can only imagine the impact that we can have if we get full backing. And with our experience in engineering, medicine, and volunteering in these shelters, we've partnered with a development team, we've won a grant from the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, and we've graduated from an accelerator program. So we want R6 Industries to become a leading international organization that can help save victims' lives and improve evacuee outcomes. So if we win today, we plan to use the money towards starting our pilot studies, but we're looking for a total of $250,000 so we can go ahead and get to product launch. And you can help us by connecting us to advisors and leaders in any of these spaces so we can work together to help underserved communities. And with that, thank you for your time, and I look forward to hearing your questions.
Take our first question.
I'll pose the first question. We too have shelters, so I'm very familiar with this situation. What else are you thinking about as you, in terms of the data that you need to collect to make the product stronger, and how will you gain access? Are you paying for the data? Are you collecting it from other sources?
Yeah, so we did the best we could with finding publicly available data, but a big problem is we weren't able to find much. And so that's one big reason that we want to go ahead and carry out these pilot studies, because there are certain things we want to track, such as unnecessary emergency room visits, the number of people that need dialysis that get sent to other places unnecessarily, and how much that costs, the time that it takes to intake all of these evacuees in these chaotic environments, essentially being sure that we can collect that and show with our system how we can improve that data. So right now, we're doing the best that we can with what we have, but we really need a lot more to understand what opportunities there are in the disaster space.
My next question is, so will this be a mobile application or a web-based platform, and also who pays for the services?
Yes, so it's a web-based platform that is compatible on mobile devices, because in a disaster, some organizations will work with, you know, cell phones or on iPads, but other ones may actually have desktops, especially if you're working, you know, at a school or some kind of place that you're having a shelter that has those capabilities. But in terms of who exactly this is targeting, so there are three specific targets. So first is the government. You know, so this would be like the Department of Public Health and the Medical Reserve Corps that actually provides volunteers and resources in disasters and actually run the shelters. The next is nonprofits and for-profits. So this could be like the Red Cross and CVS that provide those resources as well to go ahead and supplement with the government. And then finally, hospitals and insurance. You know, you have all these costs, like in Hurricane Katrina, $17 million were spent on unnecessary refills for medications. And so just having that cost alleviated in disasters can be a huge cost savings for hospitals and insurance.
Mm-hmm. Amazing. That's all the time for questions. Thank you so much, Kyle. Go Yellow Jackets. All right, next person. Macy Peterson Philatis is passionate about building businesses that help people be the best version of themselves. Macy is the CEO and co-founder of On Second Thought, the definitive delay recall mechanism for a mobile communications platform. I believe she told me that AT&T called it the texting savior. Is that correct? Fun fact, Macy comes all the way from Morocco to be here with us today. Please welcome Macy to the stage.
I am Macy Peterson Philatis, the co-founder and CEO of On Second Thought. My team is creating a world where you can not only say what you mean to say, but where others also know exactly how you meant to say it. I have an important question for you this afternoon. How many of you have sent a message you wished you could take back? Don't worry, we've all been there. So have about 71% of Americans. Whether autocorrect has a vendetta against us, or for some reason, the meaning of our message just gets lost in translation. We've all experienced it. We started as a messaging app, Ost SMS. Our proof of concept quickly spread to 190 countries and nations, and we amassed over 125,000 downloads. We would hear from our users from around the world, and they would ask us to help them fix the mistakes they were making in the platforms they used every day. For example, our users in Kenya would say, "We love your technology. Does it work in M-Pesa? Because if they send a message that they want to take back, or a payment that they want to take back, it's impossible to do so." And I'm happy to go over the other use cases of our technology in Q&A. Shortly after we were issued our first of two patents for the delay and recall of mobile communication, one of the largest telcos in the US asked us if they could license our technology. With that, we took our secret sauce and turned it into Ost Undo and Ost Money, our SDKs that get embedded directly into other platforms so that their users can fix their mistakes before they get to the recipient. I'm happy to answer questions about how our technology works in Q&A. We have three clients that represent three different industries. For our messaging client, we charge them 4.8 cents per user per month. For our enterprise client, we charge them $10 per seat per month. And for our Ost Money client, we charge them $1 per recall. As we move into the future, we see the opportunity to enable companies to understand the meaning and the sentiment behind their customers' and their employees' messages. We believe that for companies in data-poor countries, these analytics will help them make better, stronger, more meaningful, and stickier relationships with their customers and their employees. And we will do this through our message enhancement and analysis technology. On second thought is building the next message, the next operating system for messaging. We have a team that's powered by innovative technologists, and we've been featured by the Today Show, Forbes, Inc., and many other international and domestic publications. We've raised over $1 million to date from respected investors such as Backstage Capital, and we're currently raising another $1.2 million. We'll use the $35,000 prize to build and market our message analysis and enhancement technology. So I invite you to join us as we build the next operating system for messaging. Thank you.
Hi, great presentation. My first question is going back to the business model. Would you mind repeating the sales process or who purchases the platform?
Sure. So our primary customers are peer-to-peer payments platforms. They license our technology so that their end users can take back payments before they get to the other person. This is especially important in Africa where mobile wallets are really in their growth phase because many of the platforms don't enable refunds. So if you send a payment to the wrong person, you have to ask that you have to beg the wrong person to return your money to you, and there's no systemized process for undoing it. Our second category of clients are enterprise communications platforms. Right now, we're heavily focused on the customer contact center vertical because agents are typically talking to about 5 to 10 customers at once, and therefore it's very likely that they will send the wrong information to the wrong customer. And the other thing is each time a message is escalated to a phone call, that costs the platform about $20 per instance. So for larger customer contact centers, that's about $24 million a year in just escalated phone calls. And we can help reduce them by about 25%. Our third vertical is messaging platforms, especially for telcos. And they license our technology so that their customers can take back text messages before they get to the other person. Does that answer your question? Okay.
We'll take one more question.
You mentioned that you could talk a little bit more about how the tech works.
Yeah,
can you dig
absolutely.
Into that a little bit?
Yeah. So the way our technology works is platforms embed our SDK directly into their platform. They can set the maximum amount of time that their users have to undo a message or a transaction, and that can be, you know, up to, say, a minute. The end user then in the settings can set the precise amount of time that they want to have to take their message back. And so let's say they chose 5 seconds. That means that after the message is sent, they have 5 seconds to undo it, edit it, and then resend it.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you so much, Macy.
Thank you.
Anybody thinking through all the texts they wanted to recall while she was speaking?
You're welcome.
I was. Next up, we have Dr. Sana Gaspard, who's the CEO, founder, and lead inventor for RubyTection. So while she was like earning her graduate degree, this presenter also received 2 patents. So I'm 100% still believing I'm an underachiever at this point. I think we're up to 5 patents in this room. Anybody else have a patent in the room by chance? Okay, great, wonderful, yeah. So I feel really good about myself right now. Fun fact, she plays the French horn. But without further ado, Dr. Sana Gaspard.
Good luck.
Everybody has a patent. I don't have a
Good afternoon, everyone. I am Dr. Sana Gaspard. I have a doctorate in biomedical engineering. I'm the CEO of RubyTection and the primary inventor of its technology. RubyTection is a medical device company that's addressing a global healthcare problem known as bedsores by providing caregivers with a low-cost early detection tool. Our vision is to end the needless suffering and painful deaths that can be caused by a bedsore, which was experienced by the Tassel family. In 2007, Byron Tassel fell from his roof and was rushed to the hospital. At the hospital, he developed a severe bedsore. It was so severe that his skin was gone, the flesh underneath his skin was gone, and you could see all the way down to his bone. Byron would eventually die from complications of his bedsore, and his family were awarded $6.4 million in a wrongful death suit. Byron is just one of the 2.3 million Americans who are diagnosed with a bedsore every year, 60,000 of whom will die needlessly. This is because if you can detect the bedsore early, you can prevent it. But detecting it early is actually very difficult. At the early stages, it's just indicated by skin redness. In addition, the early diagnostic test is manual and unreliable. It's so unreliable that this preventable healthcare condition costs the US healthcare system $11 billion in 1 year alone. This is a cost that insurance companies are no longer covering, creating a huge clinical need and market demand for early detection tools. We're addressing that need with the RubyTect assessment system. It's a patented handheld device that allows anyone to detect a bedsore at its earliest stage, and it's used with a care management app. To date, we've already raised some initial funding, developed a prototype, and tested it on patients. Our initial results indicate that we can detect the early indicators of a bedsore. Compared to our competition, we're more reliable, we're cheaper, and we're easier to use. This will allow us to dominate our $4.8 billion US market, which includes 2 recurring revenue streams from the software and the hardware. We will sell our product into the hospitals, nursing homes, and home care markets. We will access those markets using partners that you see here, 2 of whom we're working closely with currently. The team behind RubyTection includes a group of engineers, and we surrounded ourselves with experts in the field. Today, we invite you all to be a part of our revolution to improve care and save millions of lives. We're currently raising a seed round of $1.6 million. The money from this competition will go towards that to help us build additional prototypes, collect additional data, and expand our patent portfolio. Because no one should have to die from a bedsore. It's preventable. And with our technology, will empower anyone with the ability to detect them early, to save lives, and reduce cost. Thank you.
I have 2 questions for you.
Yeah.
First one is, if you could please describe the product a little more. So how does the technology work, and how effective is it? And then the second question is, it sounds like you're raising a round right now. So can you talk about what's needed for you to go to market?
So the way the technology works, so right now the way they detect bedsores is on any bony prominence on your body, so your tailbone, your heel, they will press it and do this test and look for your skin to go from red to white. But the problem with this test, it's affected by lighting in the room. It doesn't work on people with dark skin tones independent of their race. And so you have darker skinned people getting the most severe conditions. So what we've done is developed a device that you would put on the skin. While it's on the skin, it's measuring various properties of the skin and letting you know if the tissue is healthy or not. And we're capturing that response that you see on your skin when you press it when it's red. So from that way, we can tell you if you have a bed sore currently. And we can also tell you information that's not currently available, which is what is your risk of developing a bed sore if you do not have one, right? And in terms of our raise, we're raising money to get to product development. So our $1.6 million will allow us to develop develop additional prototypes, get more data that we need to move into, to inform product development and get into product development. To get to market in total, we'll have to, because we're in the medical device space, it's going to take us about $6 million to do that. And our phases of getting into the market, our phases to get into the market is to focus on prototype and testing now, to then move into product development, and then with market launch with the support of our partners who we're already working with currently.
We'll take one more question.
I'm curious, what's the accuracy and have you been finding challenges in terms of how do you improve greater accuracy?
So in terms of the accuracy, that's what we're doing the clinical testing right now to do. So right now, in terms of the response that nurses and doctors are looking for, which is the change from skin redness to white and then back again, we can already measure that. So that was this data. So if you were looking at your hand and you pressed it, you would see that it would go from red to white, which is what you see on the arm on the left. We are able to actually capture that signal on the right-hand side with our current prototype, which is functional, right? And so we were able to show that we can measure that response with a 96% accuracy. With the money that we're raising now, we'll improve the accuracy of the system, get some more clinical data so that we can also get sensitivity and specificity, and then that will inform our design for the product development.
And I'm assuming your clinical trials are also including people of color.
Yes, ma'am, including myself.
Okay.
All right, thank you.
Thank you. All right, just a reminder, if you're live tweeting, posting on the Instagram, hashtag GHC19, hashtag PitcHER19, PitcHER. All right, next up. Lydia Basali is the head of translation services and recruitment at Naticalum. That one I was worried about, and I think I nailed it. She's dedicated herself both personally and professionally to human rights and social justice. Her work at Naticalum has included expanding the translation client base from 2 to 3 clients to over 60 and hiring 100 plus freelance refugee translators who gain an income through translation work provided by Naticalum. Fun fact. We've got a belly dancer in the group. Please welcome Lydia.
Meet Layla. She's 27, a new mom, and a former teacher from Syria. She fled the war to Turkey with her husband, where neither of them have work permits. Layla is not alone. She's one of 70 million other people that are forced to flee their homes today. Only 1% get the chance to resettle to other countries, while the rest are left in limbo, refugee camps, and countries with very little work opportunities. Yet, a lot of those displaced are highly educated. And in fact, they're highly connected. This is a photo from a refugee camp in Greece. My name is Lydia Basali, and I work at Natakallam, which means we speak in Arabic, and provides income to refugees by hiring them as language tutors and translators online, regardless of their location. For example, we have Kate, who's a PhD student studying the Middle East, and she purchases Natakallam sessions and is therefore connected to Layla, who teaches her Arabic in exchange. Kate gets affordable, flexible language services, while Layla makes an income, creating for a win-win solution. But beyond the language learning services, which are offered in Arabic, French, Persian, and Spanish, We also offer curated academic programming, as well as professional translation services provided by qualified refugee translators. All in all, we're talking about over $200 billion market in total addressable market. Netakalam operates at the crossroads of these three main pillars. First, the fact that there are many people displaced yet highly skilled. Second, the fact that we live in an increasingly interconnected world where there is a growing demand for language and cultural services. And lastly, the rise of the gig economy. So rather than being passive recipients to aid, refugees have self-generated over $650,000 through their work with us at Netakalam. And Netakalam has earned over $1 million in sales. This is through our clients, which include Yale, Duke, as well as BuzzFeed, Save the Children, among others. However, right now we're hitting a critical point where our team is having to turn away large projects due to lack of capacity. Our team is spending 40 to 60 hours a week on manual tasks. And if today we win the top prize, we'd be able to inject that towards jumpstarting a tech platform, which would free up our staff time in order to invest it rather in training and curriculum tools for our refugee tutors, as well as full-on scale marketing. We do estimate that $35,000 towards a platform will triple the number of users, and we're ultimately trying to get from that $650,000 self-generated by refugees to $1 million. We do have a multicultural team that's fostering understanding and working to counter the narrative against fear of refugees. Today, Layla is a proud mom of two and the primary breadwinner in her family. Through Netakalam, she's been connected with various students, including students in rural America. And so at a time where our leaders are talking about turning their backs against refugees and building walls, Netakalam is building bridges. Thank you.
First question.
Can you hear me? Oh, there it goes. Thank you so much for sharing. I have a couple questions. So first, can you talk a little bit about your model? Like how much do you take per task that one of the refugees does? And can you talk a little bit about, you said that you're turning away big projects and you'd like to, can you go into a little bit more detail about how you'd like to use that funding and some of the manual tasks you'd like to automate?
Absolutely. So our model, in terms of the language learning services, for example, Kate, she pays $15 an hour to have a Skype conversation with Layla. Netakalam keeps five and gives 10 directly to Layla's hands. That is for the language learning. As far as the other programs that we offer for the translation services, for example, we do keep about 25 to 30% and the rest goes towards the translator. And your next question was, remind me, I'm sorry.
What are some of the things that you are planning to automate
right.
or the programs you see?
Yeah. So this whole process, we have a current team that is manually going every month to make the payments to each refugee. And we're also doing the pairing manually where we look at the profiles of the students that are signing up and the profiles of the tutors that we have, which level are they in, which level should they teach, and then we do the pairing. And that takes an exhausting amount of time. And so a platform that unifies everything where the pairing is done through AI and also the payments are done automatically, as well as creating a place and a space where everything is unified. People are not having to use WhatsApp and Skype and Facebook Messenger and all these outside tools, but rather a platform that just makes it all unified will help help tremendously. As far as large projects that we've turned around, personally, I am the one who's heading the translation department at Netakalam, and I mean, just yesterday, we had a huge request from a client asking for potentially $20,000 project, and we don't have enough translators because I can't recruit while managing projects, while doing contracts, while doing invoicing. And so that is the projects that we've had to turn around, as well as other requests from, for example, students that want to learn other languages that we currently don't offer. So we want to be able to expand.
Thank you so much, Lydia. Appreciate it. No more time for questions. Thank you so much. Raise your hand if you speak a foreign language. Yeah, okay, just curious. Bunch of smarty pants. Assumed you all linguists too, so. Next up, we have Kristen Fang, who's the co-founder and CEO of StratiX. She's also completing her senior year at Harvard, so, a little busy. In her degree will be in computational neuroscience. Fun fact, she was in the National Youth Orchestra and she played the flute, so she's a flautist. But that's actually not the fact that I'm going to tell you. In her spare time, the scientist loves to watch corgi videos. Please welcome Kristen Fang. But I'm really here for you, Jordan.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Kristen Fang, and I'm the co-founder of StratyX. At StratyX, we democratize algorithmic trading. My co-founder and I are both seniors at Harvard, and both of us have experience in banking. Ariel was a cryptocurrency quant at Goldman Sachs, and I was an investment banker at Lazard. Both of us noticed something interesting in the finance space. More and more banks are trading on non-technical indicators. Examples of these indicators are tweets, like other social media indicators, news headlines, press releases, and more. So here's an example. In August of this year, President Trump tweeted about negotiations in the US-China trade war falling through. As a result, one man with one tweet single-handedly moved the S&P 500 down by 4%. That's equal to a loss of $90 billion across the nation. JP Morgan, however, was not affected. Why? They have an index to track the impact of Trump's tweets. Meanwhile, everyday investors, including myself, are left behind in the dust without access to a tool. So at StratyX, we built an accessible algorithmic trading tool. When we first began StratyX this year, 10,000 people signed up on our wait list, all with us spending $0 in marketing. So here's how our users use StratyX. First, they create a strategy based on indicators like tweets, news headlines, price changes, exchange rates, and more. And then, our users' favorite feature, they can test their strategy ideas on historical data and data in real time, all of this with virtual money. And then, they select the cream of the crop strategy to then automate and involve real money. We are currently available as a public beta, but once we officially launch, we plan to move towards a subscription-based pricing model with an enterprise version coming soon. There are 14 million active investors in the US, contributing to the 100 million everyday investors, and that's a $52 billion market and 100 million people who need access to this tool. Because StratyX is a software and brokerage agnostic, we have the potential to expand globally to the 500 million investors. We project that we will reach $15 million in revenue in our third year of operations, and that we will reach profitability in our second. Both my co-founder and I are deeply passionate about bringing diversity to the forefront of the fintech startup space. And we're very thankful for this opportunity to pitch for $35,000, which will enable us to reach more people by making our platform available on the Android store and also on web-based application. I thank you so much for this opportunity.
Thank you. A couple of first questions. So you mentioned 10,000 people signed up for your wait list.
Yes.
How many people are using you today, and what are some of the interesting things you've learned from some of your early users?
That's a great question. So we are a public beta as of this week, and prior to then, we were a private beta. From there, for the private beta, we selected 200 users from the waitlist to test the app. And we've been working closely with them in the last month to really develop and work on product market fit. One thing that we learned is that they absolutely love the historical testing feature because there's no other app out there that allows them to test their trading ideas on things like tweets, news, price changes, and more.
My question is, will this integrate with existing trading platforms?
So StratyX is brokerage agnostic, and it's a software that sits on top of an API connecting to your brokerage. So let's say you have a TD Ameritrade account, then you would go into the StratyX app, click connect a brokerage, and then your TD Ameritrade info will pop in. You put in your login information, and then it's connected securely there. So no actual money flows through StratiX. StratiX is kind of just another user, sort of like your little tool in your side pocket, watching the market and letting you know when some events come up, or it'll execute a trade for you if you approve it.
We'll take one more question.
Yeah, can you talk a little bit about what you're thinking for the enterprise version?
Yeah, that's a great question. So one interesting thing we realized is a lot of clients of private wealth management firms always have a portion of their portfolio, generally around 10%, that they want to actively invest and manage on their own. And with the rise of fintech, they realize that they also don't have a tool, unless they're very technical, to trade in an efficient way, even though they're aware that there are tools out there. Like, banks have those tools, but they're not accessible to everyday investors. So we are partnering with PWMs in order to make this tool available to their clients.
Amazing. Thank you so much,
Thank
Kristen.
Thank you.
Okay, who watches corgi videos? Is that like a thing? Gosh, it is with the youth. All right, everybody feeling all right? A little stretch. We have three more presenters. Judges, you all right? Everybody okay? Sponsors in the back, you okay? Yes? Okay, I'm just checking energy levels. Okay, next up, Chanel Fields, who is the founder of MD Ally, an EMS telemedicine platform that enables collaborative partnerships between public safety and provider organizations for large-scale mobile integrated healthcare initiatives. I asked her where her last trip was, and she got to go on her first trip to Africa, to Ghana and Senegal. So please welcome Chanel Fields.
Okay, if I were to ask you what was the first number that you learned to call as a child, most of you would say 911. And that's because we're taught from a very young age that if something really hurts, you call 911 and you go to the ER. And we haven't forgotten. Each year, over 96 million non-emergency calls decrease ambulance availability, overcrowd the ER, and drive billions of dollars in excess cost. My name is Chanel Fields, and I'd like to show you what the impact of that is.
Anybody else available out there? Anybody available out there that can take a run?
A dispatcher pleading for ambulances.
How often does that happen?
Daily. Sometimes several times a day.
Now, this is a life or death issue. And for some people, like Catherine Terry, a heart attack victim, who called 911 and had to wait more than 30 minutes for an ambulance to arrive. Or, like Malaya Jeffers, who went to the ER on a day it was overcrowded with an infection. She had to wait more than 5 hours before being seen, and that infection spread throughout her body. In order to save her life, surgeons had to amputate her left hand, a few of her right fingers, and both of her legs below the knee. Research actually shows that this is not rare. So if we could eliminate non-emergency call volume, we could save about 15,000 heart attack victims every single year and lower critical emergency room wait times. So I am the daughter of a volunteer EMT, and that was really my first introduction into the EMS space. And I spent about a year traveling around the country doing ride-alongs with firemen and EMTs to learn this issue further and meet patients that were driving this non-emergency call volume. And what we've done is we've put together a really great team that has experience in the healthcare space, military, and mobile technology that's focused on launching our platform. Now, the current challenge is that there's one pathway when you call 911, and it goes straight to emergency care. At MDLI, we're integrating telemedicine into the dispatch process in order to allow triage to more appropriate sites of care. We're also working on high-impact partnerships with MITRE and the VA that will introduce technology that detects PTSD and speech patterns for folks calling 911 that need to be navigated to more appropriate mental health facilities. Our customers are public safety, payer organizations, and providers that make up a total of addressable market of about $140 billion every single year. Now, we are excited that we've already launched our platform, and we have about 45 new cities that went into our pipeline this year and are also negotiating two large payer deals that would cover about 22 states. We're raising our seed round of $750, and we would use the funding from Grace Hopper in order to launch our initial pilot in King County, Washington, D.C., that serves over about 2.2 million citizens. Thank you.
So, great presentation and desperately needed, definitely. You said some of the challenges, because we have that linear to call 911. As you've piloted, or as you've had some new customers, what are some of the learning experiences that you're seeing there, and how are you tweaking it or bringing it back
to resolve? So we go live in January of 2020. So next year is when we're going live with that county in Washington. But we did spend about a year traveling to six different cities that have launched non-emergency pilots before. So these aren't commercial ventures, they're run by the city. And that actually drove a lot of key and important learnings for us as we saw their process. For example, Houston, they actually put physicians in their dispatch centers to answer some of these calls. And we learned a lot of opportunities around optimizing those processes and also getting better unit economics to scale as physicians can take calls from multiple dispatch centers across the state.
Can you talk a little more about the product and what you're going to market with?
And where we're what?
So like what, how will the product work once you launch?
Yeah, so the way that the product will work is basically a dispatch center currently can do something called a one-button transfer, so they'll be able to transfer that caller over to our platform, and on our platform, providers will be available to deliver virtual medical and behavioral health care. And then after that initial assessment, we'll do things like triage those patients to providers that can either provide deeper follow-up care or also community resources. So we're working on some partnerships related to 211 services. So it can be like food banks or getting them set up with health insurance, but essentially connecting them to the most appropriate resources.
So just a quick follow-up there. Does that imply that everybody that would call in with a medical emergency or a medical need would automatically get transferred to your platform and then the true emergencies get transferred back, or how does that work?
Yeah, so when you call 911 today, you reach a dispatcher who asks you a series of rapid-fire questions that determines the level of emergency of that call. We come after that determination is already made. So once it's determined that it's low acuity, today the process is that they'll still dispatch an ambulance. It's just either basic life support or advanced life support. But we take those low acuity callers that are determined by a determinant code, essentially, and those are now eligible to be triaged over to our platform.
That's all of our time. Thank you so much, Chanel. Somebody in the crowd just said, so these women are like really smart. And I'm like, yeah. Also, when you listen to their pitches in 3 minutes, I realize I should waste less time on social media and get to work, you know, getting my patents and all. All right, couple more. Next up, we have Amy Hatterer. Amy's a childbirth assistant, a doula, artist, birth activist, and founder of Motherboard Birth. For over a decade, Amy has provided hands-on support to hundreds of families during the childbearing years. And we know she's busy because Amy is the mother of six and running a company. And she wanted me to let you know she's the mother of six, but she's not Catholic or Mormon. Please welcome Amy Hatterer.
Good luck.
Hello, everybody. My name is Amy, and I'm the founder of Motherboard Birth. Over the past 11 years, I've served hundreds of families in their birth experience, helping them navigate that process and really become intimately aware of some of the challenges facing perinatal health today. This really hit home for me when my best friend Rebecca almost died of a postpartum hemorrhage. They actually told her that soaking a pad every 10 minutes and losing consciousness was normal, and they tried to send her home. You might not realize this, but the United States has the worst maternal mortality rate of the developed world, and it's actually climbing. But the scarier statistic is that for every one person who dies during birth, 70 people almost die, and Black women are 3 to 4 times more likely to die during birth than their white counterparts. Not to mention, 1 out of 3 people describe their births as traumatic. While this is a complicated problem, motherboard is a facet of the solution. We focus on education, informed choice, and communication through our visual birth plan app, online childbirth ed, and iDecide, our care provider tool. We are not your mama's birth plan. On our app, parents can research and select their birth preferences from our vast content, invite their team to collaborate, and then export and share their motherboard in real time as they go into labor. iDecide, our care provider tool, helps doctors and midwives provide timely, evidence-based information at the bedside to help parents make truly informed decisions. We also enhance discharge instructions to help people come back in for care as soon as possible if they're experiencing complications. Current revenue streams come from paid app access, our partner program, as well as licensing content to other companies. And competitors in this space are usually either telehealth or they're content companies that are focused on providing content to hospitals. But we're the only enterprise-ready, scalable SaaS platform that takes that education and transforms it into a communication tool. Our market's pretty broad, with 4 million births per year and $155 billion spent annually. But where we really shine is this trend towards value-based care. So instead of paying for intervention after intervention, focusing on tools that improve satisfaction, outcomes, and lower cost. To reach a wide audience, we have cultivated some great partnerships over the past year with fertility companies, universities, certifying bodies, and other content companies. My team is amazing, with 80 plus years experience not only in the maternal health space, but also building exclusive health technology. And we've had a lot of exciting traction over the past year with 1,200 total users, 140 paid partners, $34,000 in revenue, 5 pilot sites for iDecide and counting, strategic partnerships, and lots of positive reviews. If chosen, we would use this money towards much-needed app development to build a robust portal-based platform so we can better serve hospitals, systems, care providers, and our existing partner program. Thank you so much.
Okay, so you have two kinds of users right now. So you have consumers, and then you also have paid partners. Mm-hmm. So can you talk about what you've learned from the two different categories?
Yeah, well, definitely. So our B2C component, which is any parent can sign up for the app and create their motherboard, that's obviously super challenging because we're only relevant for about 6 to 9 months in somebody's life, and we have 100% churn rate, right? Nobody's pregnant, hopefully, forever. We're really accessing that market through our partnerships with the Kindara and Prematemp fertility apps, so we're going to be able to integrate our content into their pregnancy mode and start building those relationships from the minute they pee on a stick. And then our partner program is mostly childbirth educators and doulas such as myself, some midwives, but basically they let us know how many memberships they need per year, and then we add them to our system and they pass out vouchers. Yeah.
I have a question in terms of cultural integration.
Yes.
You mentioned the data on particularly African American women, which is alarming for a country like the U.S. How are you incorporating the cultural aspects of childbirth into your platform to broaden your consumer base?
Definitely. It's really important that visually that people of color are represented on our app so that we can show everybody that they can have a supported and physiologic birth experience. We're hoping to empower and help them advocate for things that are important to them. It's obviously a very complicated, layered system, working with providers to recognize their biases. We're also working on a training program to work with L&D units and providers to talk to them about what informed choice is and how they can communicate and deal with outliers and recognize the pressures that are on them from a very compassionate and internal piece. So yeah, that's part of what we're working on.
And last question is about doulas and connecting within the platform. Is there an option to connect with health resources or anyone who would be able to help you through this process?
I'm sorry, I didn't catch that last
connecting
part.
Within the motherboard platform, connecting with different doulas or recommendations for healthcare platform. Okay.
Yeah, definitely. So if a partner signs up, we add them to our website so you can look in your geographic location to see if there's any doulas that are on board with our process. And then parents can also, when they log on and they create an account, they invite their best friend, their doula, their mother-in-law, and you get an invitation to collaborate so they can see all your preferences in real time. So you'll be able to communicate that way as well.
Thank you so much, Amy.
Thank you.
Mother of six. You are the motherboard. She is the motherboard. I'm just surprised you could take some time to be with us. Amazing. Okay, last but not least, we've got Lin Zhu, who's the co-founder and CFO of Loro Company, an intuitive and inclusive robotics startup developing smart assistive companion for wheelchair users, being a game changer for 70 million wheelchair users. She's currently a junior at Harvard University, where she runs the largest student-run Women in CS conference in the country. Also, Lin is a scientist who loves art history. Please welcome Lin Zhu. Good luck.
I want you to meet my friend, Steve. He has an 8-year-old son, and they love baseball. But Steve has ALS. He's immobilized in a big, black, bulky wheelchair. He can't turn to see his son next to him, cheering happily. And Steve also can't cheer along, because he's lost his voice. Worldwide, there are 70 million people with mobility challenges, like ALS, multiple sclerosis, cerebral palsy, or that are wheelchair-bound. And currently, we don't know solutions and we don't see solutions for that are accessible and affordable for our friends in wheelchairs. My name is Lin, co-founder and CFO. I'm a junior at Harvard, and currently I have 5 teammates working full-time to solve this problem. Meet Loro. Loro is a smart companion device and an app, offering a suite of features, including a smart camera, communication, smart home, and this suite is affordable. It's $800 for the device and $80 per month for the app. And this gives users control, connection, and communication. It's user-friendly, and it's so greatly needed. Let's see how Steve uses Loro.
We easily attach Loro onto Steve's wheelchair. Next, Steve easily downloads our user-friendly app. Now, Loro is ready to use everywhere he goes. Loro has a 360 rotating camera, allowing Steve to have a broader field of vision and to drive his wheelchair more safely. Here, Jack is controlling Loro with his eyes, as Loro can be controlled hands-free by all kinds of input devices, including eye tracking, head mouses, and joysticks. Next, communication. For example, when Loro sees a bottle of water, Loro suggests sentences like, "Can I have a bottle of water?" or "I am thirsty." Next, there is the smart follow cam. For example, when Loro meets Johei, the camera is centered on Johei, following moving people or objects as a smoother form of communication. An integrated smart home allows users to have seamless control of their homes, like turning on and off lights and controlling temperatures with the blink of an eye.
This is a $40 billion market, and in 2021, we have a $4.3 million EBITDA. We plan to distribute through partnerships as well as directly to customers. And we've already raised $500,000. We need $200,000 to be able to launch our product in 2020. We have strong traction with 100 pre-orders. And I need your help today, because with $35,000, we'll be able to finish our product development and be able to finish our user testing to launch our product in 2020. So I hope you'll join Loro in our sprint to make independence and accessibility a reality for Steve and his family and for the 70 million wheelchair users out there who need it the most. Thank you.
Thank you. Can you talk a little bit about what needs to happen between now and shipping the product and what, you know, that $35K is going to be going toward?
Yes. So right now we are finishing up our user testing and our product development for Loro 1.0, which includes the features shown in the video. So right now we're trying to finish that by the end of this year. And by then, that will be what the $35K will be used for. And then we will be actually manufacturing with the rest of the fundraising we make and actually delivering.
And how much will it cost to manufacture a unit?
Yeah, I can show you the slide with unit economics. So right here, manufacturing would be $100 per unit, and those are the cost breakdowns. So basically, the profit per unit is $600 plus our $80 per month.
And last question for me. And can you talk a little bit more about the partnerships and how you're going to reach potential users?
Absolutely. So with our partnerships, we have partnerships with we're talking with the Massachusetts General Hospital right now, and we are talking with the ALS Association, as well as the Veterans Affairs. So they would essentially help us market and help us promote, and they would make a percentage of sales. And then we'll also sell directly to customers. We're working with insurance companies to make sure that this can also be affordable and accessible.
Can you talk about the innovation that you have? So does the company have any defensible assets?
Could you repeat the last?
So do you have any defensible assets, meaning like IP for your solution?
Yes, we have 3 patents pending right now. And essentially the product is that first it's the device and then it's the app which has hands-free eye tracking. And it's the integration of all of these in a very user-friendly way that currently does not exist, right? Currently, it's a lot of different technologies that are very expensive and hard to use together.
And is there only one variation of the subscription model, or is it something else that will be rolling out about that?
Yes, so currently our business model for 2020 when we roll it out, that will be just one version of this $80 per month subscription model. However, as we develop with more features of Loro that are more user-friendly and more data analytics involved with it, we will have new subscription tiers.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Lynn.
Great job. All right, everybody take a deep breath in. Woosa. Let's give one more round of applause for Yolkinde, Lydia, Amy, Asha, Kristen, Kyle, Vreshte, Lynn, Sana, Macy, Chanel. Stand up, ladies. Stand up. You did it. You did it, and I didn't even have to yank anybody off stage, so I appreciate you keeping your time. You could have a seat. I'd also like to take a minute to thank the pitch coach, Brandon Andrews. Brandon, where are you at? Brandon is the co-founder of Gage, an AI-driven mobile market research platform connecting brands to consumers and influencers. He's also the person that's helping Shark Tank get even more diverse, so talk to Brandon. Fun fact about Brandon, he was a Division I track athlete and he could do the triple jump. And I was just wondering if you wanted to demonstrate real quick. You good? Okay. I'd also like to take a minute to thank our judges before we send them off to the bunker. Thank you, Alejandra, Christy, Shakia, and Kat. One round of applause for the judges. To our friends at home, we're gonna go dark for about 20 minutes. Remember, hashtag GHC19, hashtag PitcherNineteen. During these 20 minutes, the lovely judges are gonna go to their bunker to deliberate. And when we come back, we will award $100,000. While we're on break, we have some food and drinks for those of you at home. Go get a snack. And take a moment to visit with our sponsors, Hertz, Grasshopper Bank, Service Titan, American Family Insurance, WePay, and Micron. Also, for the audience award, you see these instructions? Follow them. You have to be a registered attendee to be able to access the app. So if you're sitting in your hotel room because you're tired and you've already walked 25,000 steps, you can vote. But if you're at home and not registered for Grace Hopper celebration this year, unfortunately, you cannot participate in the audience. Any questions about that? Don't ask me, ask someone smarter than me. Was that fun? How many co-founders or founders do we have in the room outside of our contestants? Wow, amazing. How many patents again? Tell me later, I don't even want to hear about it. All right, we're gonna take a break. We've got 20 minutes. We'll give you a 5-minute warning to come back and take your seats. Enjoy the refreshments and enjoy some amazing swag from our sponsors. GHC 19, PitcherHER 19, that's a wrap until we give away the checks. We'll see you in 20 minutes.
Third, when the winner comes up, she just slides into the
And that's
Thank you. right there if you cannot hear me. Are we good? No? I am not on. I think. Are we good?
Keep talking amongst yourselves. That was this mic.
Everybody watching at home, meaning my mother.
Hang tight.
Everybody have some good snacks? I didn't have any. Did you save anything for me? No? Yeah. Y'all can go home, no checks. Okay. All right, we ready? And we're back. Whoa! I told you I didn't need a mic. Everybody on the socials, hashtag GHC19, hashtag PitcherNineteen. You ready for all these winners? I'm at Go Left Mitali if you would like to talk to me. I'll talk back. Just want to once again thank our sponsors, Hertz, Grasshopper Bank, Service Titan, American Family Insurance, WePay, and Micron. But we're really excited, before we give away these checks, our fearless leader, the woman who had the glass of wine with Dr. Quincy Brown and then asked me to be the MC, also known as the CEO of AnitaB.org, please welcome Brenda Darden-Wilkerson.
Oh, hi, y'all. I'm so excited to see you. Isn't this great? This is amazing. So I just want to share. I just wanted to say hi. I wanted to thank you for being here. This is really exciting for me because this was just like an idea a couple of years ago to start something like this. We believed that we were leaving out a really critical group of women and we needed to turn our focus to them, women founders. And so we're so excited to have our second annual PitcHER today. We're so excited that we have our judges, and amongst them was the winner from last year, yes, right? And we're just so excited for the future trend. You know, I'm gonna go ahead and, you know, tell y'all a secret. You're not gonna tell anybody, right? Okay. You know, we have great aspirations for this work. And eventually, we'd like to actually raise a fund. Now, I know how to spell fund, that's about it. But we want to get there because we want to make sure that we are able to support founders in multiple ways year-round, and also that we're able to encourage technical women to fund, to actually invest, right? So I'm so excited to be here. I'm so excited. Thank you so much to sponsors who believed in us and believed in this commitment and this work. And I want to thank Dr. Quincy Brown for picking up and taking this forward. It's amazing. And thank you to our MC, the mighty Mitali. So awesome. So awesome. Okay, but I just kind of wanted to show up and show some love because I'm really excited that you're all here, and I'm excited for all of the brilliant women. We couldn't break it down to our 10, right? That's exciting. We're supposed to get to 10, we just couldn't, so we went to 11, and so that's meaningful. We want to make sure that we lift up amazing women and that we make sure that we are never hashtag erased, unerasable, right? Okay, so without further ado, I'm going to turn it back over so we can do some good stuff. Thank you again for coming.
Awesome. Well, thank you. So, Mitali, I just want to give her another round of applause. And again, thank Brenda for having the vision to do this work. So I am Quincy Brown. I think my name has been said a few times. And you can see why Brenda and I one evening sat down and thought, who could we get to be the host for PitcHER? And then we both like had this light bulb moment at the same time and thought, Mitali. She is going to keep it moving, keep it lively, and really be supportive and engaging. And so, but most importantly, I really want to thank you all for coming and spending these few hours with us and supporting, for voting for your favorites, for giving the pitchers all of the support. So let's give them all a round of applause. It is absolutely, I'm standing here looking out. It's not easy to be up here, and it's not really, I'm sure, even harder to be up here when you're talking about your business and all of your accomplishments, and so I really appreciate the 11 finalists for taking their time, sharing what they do, what they're passionate about with all of us here. And so now the moment that we've all been waiting for, I'm going to invite the judges up. So we've been choreographing the pictures and all of that, and so we'll invite the judges up. Brenda's going to come back. And the sponsors. So we've got this whole,
can we get
like
a representative from all the sponsors to come up? I think one rep. We got them?
They already know who they are. Right. They're gonna stand there. The judges are gonna come on the stage. Brenda's coming back. Mitali's gonna do the announcements. We'll do pictures and all of that.
Y'all are so quiet and nervous. Just making, Ashley says, yes. Come this way. Come this way. I don't think I've seen. Do we have any of our amazing AnitaB.org board members in the room right now? I don't remember. Do I see? I can't see. If we have any of our board members in the room, please come on up. Okay? All right. We good? We good? This is the moment. Okay. First prize for the audience award, meaning those of you that voted and voted at home, we have $20,000. Is that right? Did I get that number right? Okay. For Loro Lin Zhu. Come on up, come on. Congratulations. Let's give it up for Lin, ladies and gentlemen. So I've been told you don't actually take that to the bank. There's some other check. Have you ever been to a bank and actually seen somebody walk up with one of those? It was me. Next up, for third place, $20,000. I'm just confirming these monies. These are monies. That's a lot of money. I just have to confirm the numbers. Our third place winner is MD Ally, Chanel Fields. Why am I so nervous? And I even have the names right here. Okay. Second place for $25,000. Confirming the monies. Confirming the monies. Strati X, Kristen Fang. Congratulations! You did it! You did it!
Thank you.
Lift it up, lift it up. All right, friends, before we announce the winner, let's just one more time, a big round of applause for all of our competitors today. Let me hear it. You know, you are all winners. The work that you're doing is amazing. And please know there's many people in this room. For those that maybe didn't get a check today, there are checks for you in your future. It's amazing. Guys, I'm nervous again, and I still have the answer. Okay, first place for the 2019 PitcHER winner at Grace Hopper Celebration is for $35,000, correct? Ruby Tekshin, Dr. Sana Gaspard. She's a check. You get a hug. Amazing. That's really all I'm supposed to be doing. However, I just wanted to thank all of our judges. Once again, thank you so much. We know it wasn't easy. This isn't in our run of show, but judges, any last words on the deliberation? Anything you'd like to share? Anything else? But very hard. Would you like to say anything, Sana, as the winner? Yeah, come on up here. You won, girl. Here, I'll hold it. I'll give it back. Don't worry.
I would first like to thank my fellow startup company. Sorry, I'm a little in shock that I won. I mean, thank you, everyone. Yeah! Thank you, judges. Thank you for the opportunity to be here, and thank you most of all to the other competitors. I think what they're all doing is really good. They're fabulous women, and even if I won, I feel like we should also support them however we can, because it takes everyone to move things forward. And you always have to sometimes have one winner, but it doesn't mean the losers are not as good. But I wanted to thank you all for your support, and also let's work together to see how we can support all of the finalists, because all of the companies, I think, are kick-ass. Like, really. Girls, and thank you for this opportunity.
All right, we'd like to thank the sponsors, the judges. Thanks to our pitch coach, Brandon. Great job. You worked with each one individually. Brenda, thank you for having the vision to bring this to Anita B, to Dr. Quincy Brown, and to Drew. Where's Drew at? Everybody wave. Everybody knows Drew. Everybody know Drew? Thank you so much. I forgot to ask you this, but if they want to learn more about PitcHER, potentially coming to other cities, to other competitions, go to the AnitaB.org website, send email to Dr. Quincy Brown. We're in this together, friends. You all are here because you're inspired by founders and by women. And we had that visual at the very beginning of the day. So many of you are doing amazing work to help bring more female founders and people of color to the forefront. And so I appreciate your dedication of listening and being here and helping support that movement. So AnitaB.org is gonna do their part, and we appreciate all that you do too. If you need anything else, find me on the Twitters. And if you know me, you know that usually there's something cheeky that I'm doing. I have my own hashtag, it's called the O-Town Get Down. So thanks for coming from my O-Town Get Down. PitcHER 19, we're out. Have a good night.